Hello, my name is Kala Mehta, and I'm here to speak about South Asians and dementia. I represent the Stanford Geriatric Education Center.
At the end of this module, you will be able to distinguish the effects of culture on the views of dementia in the South Asian community, utilize appropriate assessment tools with South Asian older adults, and integrate culturally specific strategies to work effectively with the family of South Asian older adults with dementia.
And what I'd like to draw your attention to is the picture here on the first slide. In any culture, we'd like to treat our elders with dementia with respect and really honor the process that they go through. And I think this photo encapsulated. It's courtesy of the World Alzheimer's Report. The slides that I'm going to show you are broken up into four different segments. The background, incidence and prevalence of dementia, assessment, and family caregiving. I'll start with background. We all know that dementia is an extremely costly disease. The total cost of dementia in 2010 was $604 billion. That's 70% of the global cost going to actually Northern America and Western Europe. So for those regions of the world, it's actually very, very high. And the annual cost of caring for people with Alzheimer's disease is another $172 billion, which is just an astoundingly large number. And when you compare that cost to revenue of really large companies like Walmart or ExxonMobil, you'll see that the total cost of dementia is actually larger. So it's a very, very costly and important problem. One of the reasons that dementia is so costly and one of the reasons that dementia is an increasing problem is that people everywhere in the world are living longer. This slide depicts how people in the United States are living longer, in countries like Japan and Germany, in India, Brazil, China. All of the countries are showing trends of higher life expectancies. And when that happens, people accrue dementia more. Where is that growth happening? Well, it's really happening in both high-income countries and low and middle income countries. And when you look at what the growth projections are, those low and middle income countries are really going to contribute even more to the total numbers of people with dementia. So places like India and China. This talk is really focusing in on the South Asian population. So we wanted to define it. What does South Asian mean? South Asian means that people are coming from a whole subcontinent of countries, India, Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Burma and Myanmar, Sri Lanka, which is an island, and the Maldives, also islands. And so it really spans a very large geographic area. And we're going to hone that down into the South Asian population that is here in the United States. And as you would expect, because of cultural and migration influences, the South Asian population has population centers or places where they gravitate. Those are, as you can see from this picture of the United States, places like New York, Chicago, Texas, and California, where the populations are really quite large. And often South Asians will live in, you know, towns or cities where there are many South Asian people living, and maybe there'll even be a little India complex where you can buy Indian groceries or perhaps go to an Indian restaurant. What we know about South Asians, so people coming from those countries like India and Pakistan to the United States, is that population of older adults is growing. It's going to double in the next 40 years from approximately 226,000 to 452,000 older adults of South Asian origin residing here in the United States. And we got this information from the U.S. Census and its middle projections. Now, the South Asian population of older adults is not uniform. As you can imagine, they're coming from lots of different countries. But another thing that's really characteristic about why they're different is that there are different ways that they've entered the country. Some of them came as early immigrants. They were the doctors, the lawyers, the engineers who came to the United States because of increased need for those technical skills, and then they've aged in place. And there are another set of South Asian older adults who had adult children migrate to the United States, and then they followed their adult children, sometimes to play a role as a grandparent or to help out with multi-generational families. So we describe this as bimodal. The South Asian population in the U.S. is very diverse. As you can imagine, there are many languages spoken from these populations like Hindi, Urdu, Gujarati, Tamil, Malayalam, Telugu, Bengali, and Punjabi. And there are really no good estimates on those language breakdowns for the older adult population. Similarly, the South Asian older adult population is diverse in its religious affiliation. So about half are Hindu, about 18% are Christian, 5% are Sikh, 2% are Jain, 1% is Buddhist, and then there's a whole other religious component, so from Islam, that may have not been measured in this particular survey. So diverse religious affiliation. So in working with South Asian older adults, we at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center would like to convey a way of working with patients that we feel is most appropriate. And it borrows from the principles of cultural humility. This is a framework that was developed by Jan Murray Garcia, and it really has the idea of listening to a patient regarding their cultural preferences. And that really works well for South Asians because they are so diverse and they may have so many different language groups, different religious affiliations. It's probably best to just listen to the patient and understand their preferences than to try to guess what their cultural preferences would be without asking them. So I think that the references are really quite helpful here in that regard. I think this idea of asking the patient about their cultural preferences comes up a lot with dementia patients, in particular in regards to decision making and also in regards to the end of life care. And so that's very, very important. And why would it be a good idea to ask the patient and use principles of cultural humility when you're talking to a patient? Well, it may actually impact outcomes.